welcome you to our session. I'd like to start off first by thanking all of the presenters and panelists that have been on today. The sessions have been so informative, and I just want to thank everyone for their extra effort. I want to remind you all to use the chat on the right-hand side of the screen if you have any questions. We're going to keep the questions to the end, and I'll be monitoring the chat throughout. My name is Dr. Elizabeth Krimble, and I'm happy to be serving as your moderator for this session. It is an honor to be helping out with the Living Donor Registry. This is a topic very close to my heart. I am the mother of a kidney transplant recipient, and I am the wife of a kidney donor. So this is a perfect fit. I'd just like to share with you, in 2021, Donate Life America is launching the National Donate Life Living Donor Registry. This is a national reaching living donor registry with the goal of reducing access barriers for prospective living donors. The Donate Life Living Donor Registry is being generously funded by the Fresenius Medical Care Foundation, and DLA is working with key partners, including the United Network for Organ Sharing, Life Logics, Care DX, and the National Kidney Foundation. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce you to our presenters today. We have David Fleming, the President and CEO of Donate Life America, and we also have Sydney Brown, the Senior Program Coordinator for the National Living Donor Assistance Center. We will be having a prize for the questions, and the prize for this session is an insulated, you know, mug. So welcome everyone, and welcome to our presenters. I'll turn it over to y'all.
Great, thank you, Elizabeth. Elizabeth said, my name is David Fleming, and I'm proud to be the President and CEO of Donate Life America, in a position that I've been holding now for 21 years. I like to say that my career at Donate Life America can drink now. So you can go to the next slide, Joseph. So I wanted to start by wishing everybody a happy National Pediatric Transplant Week. I really want to take a moment to thank our partners in this celebration, particularly including our transplant families. I want to give a special thank you to Melissa McQueen, Joseph Hillenberg, and Jen Lau, who served as really a catalyst for this, what is now annual celebration. And really help force the growth of this opportunity for National Pediatric Transplant Week. So thank you to those folks for being such a great catalyst for this. You can see here our host of partners that we are grateful to for assisting us with this. And with the pandemic, so much of what we're doing now is social media. And I can tell you that this is by far one of our most popular events of the year, and certainly one of our most popular events during National Donate Life Month, which is, of course, here in April. Next slide. So just a little bit about Donate Life America. Donate Life America is a national 501c3. We are committed to increasing the number of donated organs, eyes, and tissue to save and heal lives, and an overarching goal of having our culture embrace organ, eye, and tissue donation as a fundamental human responsibility. Next slide. And this has been a creative umbrella that we've really been working under for the last 4 or 5 years. And it's to provide hope, healing, and life to as many people as possible, as creatively as necessary. And something we certainly pride ourselves on at Donate Life America is continuing to really push the creative envelope, not just with messaging that is going to get people's attention, but importantly, creativity and how we reach out to people outside of our typical circle. Right now, Donate Life America staff and our board are really looking at how we can increase the touch points we have with consumers, working with organizations like Apple and iPhone and our health app to provide the opportunity for people to register, working with our advertising agency, the Martin Agency, with creative campaigns that you hopefully have seen over the last several years, and excited to say there are going to be a couple of really good new exciting home runs from a campaign perspective. Hopefully many of you saw a recent campaign that we just launched with Canva, which we have had out on social media, which is just a really exciting opportunity to give you an example of what we're talking about. Next slide. So, you know, these numbers probably better than I do. We currently have more than 90,000, over 100,000 actually, patients waiting for kidney transplants. There were 39,000 transplants performed, kidney transplants performed in 2020, and 5,700 of those came from living donors. And what I'm going to talk to you about today is Donate Life America's decision to get involved in trying to increase that 5,700 number, to increase the number of transplants that are available and saving lives through increasing living donation. Next slide. So what's the need? We all know that we currently have over 100,000 people waiting. Unfortunately, if every single American was registered as an organ and tissue donor, we still would not have enough kidneys to meet the demand. So we started looking at how can Donate Life America use these consumer touch points that we have? How can we use the volume of people that are coming to Donate Life America to primarily find out how to register as a deceased donor? And how can we use that same volume of activity to begin to increase the number of lives saved? So one of the statistics here, the second bullet, and this comes from one of our fantastic partners, John Snyder, with the Scientific Registry for Transplant Recipients, or the SRTR. And in doing research on another project, they discovered that for every 35 living donors that go through to transplant, there are likely at least another 26 that were cleared to be a donor that ended up not donating because another family member or friend may have been a better match. So it wasn't because they didn't have the intent to donate. They had already been cleared medically. So the ability to just capture that 26 and to allow them to stay part of the system and to offer this opportunity for life was something that was very intriguing to us. We also recognize that our transplant centers, while they are incredibly dedicated and committed to increasing living donation, don't necessarily have the, they're not equipped, they don't have the infrastructure to be able to deal with an abundance of living donor prospects. As we see people responding to national stories about living donation, reaching out to a transplant center to see if they may be a match. And really sometimes seeing our transplant center partners overwhelmed with how to figure out navigating, bringing in hundreds of potential donors to possibly save lives. And then of course, we know that the majority of the public expresses support for living donation. However, we have seen that number remain flat for the most part. We have seen some incremental growth, but certainly we haven't seen the kind of growth that we have seen, for example, in transplants from deceased donors. So Donate Life America made the decision that we wanted to find a way to use the resources and the activities that we have to try and improve those numbers. Next slide. So to let you know, when we started this, we pulled together just a fantastic work group to help us guide us through this process to make sure that Donate Life America was choosing to insert itself into an additive place. We're not looking to cannibalize the work of any organizations that are doing fantastic work in the area of living donation already. We wanted to use the access that we have to the American public to insert ourselves at an appropriate point to where it was going to be additive and not cannibalizing the work of other organizations like you're going to hear from NLDAC. They do a fantastic job. We want to be I always like to say we want to be the moon, not the sun, when it comes to things like living donor assistance. We want to shine light on the people that are already doing a great job for that and make it available. So where could Donate Life America uniquely insert itself? And this was our advisory group, which is really a who's who of the donation and transplant community. Just very grateful to their support. In particular, we'd like to call out Dr. Cooper from Georgetown University, who's become part of a smaller group that's really had his hands and his fingers involved in what we're doing. Dr. Hippen as well, along with John Snyder, who's done a fantastic job with us, helping us with our research, and Jeff Sterrett, who is the chief technology officer at LifeLogix, who is the genius behind a lot of the programming that you're going to see me demonstrate here in a little bit. Next slide. Oh, and I left off, I didn't see her name on the list, Jennifer Milton, who was the board chair of Donate Life America, who is the key administrator down at University Transplant Center in San Antonio, has just been a fantastic champion of this. She works in a transplant center. They're involved in living donation, and we really couldn't be getting this off the ground without her incredible support and innovation and her commitment to this process. You heard earlier the list of our partners here, just a gigantic thanks to Fresenius Medical Care Foundation, who is our funding partner in this. I would like to say, those of you that have been involved in donation and transplantation for a while, know that sometimes our partners on the dialysis side get dinged a little bit. So it's just fantastic to see Fresenius really putting effort behind not just talking the talk, but walking the walk and investing in how they can save the lives of the patients that they are treating every day through their dialysis clinics and help them find a transplant so they can continue and resume more normal life. Next slide. So when I talked about the appropriate way for Donate Life America to insert itself in this living donor outreach and this living donor pathway, it really all begins with our national registry, which we launched in partnership with Apple and iPhone. We currently have now over 8 million registrations in our national registry. So this is the umbrella national online registry that lays over top of the incredible work of our DMV partners and our state teams that have worked to register over 165 million Americans, or over 65% of adults in the United States over the last 10 to 12 years. And so we have this volume of activity, people every day, more than 4,000 people every day coming to us to register their decision to be a deceased donor. So we wanted to figure out how we could effectively leverage this volume of activity to offer a living donor option to these people, as I like to say, are already in a state of generosity. They've already made the decision that they want to give. So could we give them the option of learning more about living donation with the potential long-term possibility of them actually becoming a living donor? So these are just some of the statistics that I just went over. One of the exciting things is we now have over 1,400 campaign pages, 700 organizational pages, where organizations are giving people the ability to register via a link on their campaign page so they can track how many lives they're impacting, how many people are registering to be an organ, eye, and tissue donor. Our registry is used by all of our organ recovery, tissue, and eye partners, with over 2.5 million donor searches conducted on the National Registry in the last 24 months. Next slide. So as we have designed the National Living Donor Registry, there are really two points of entry as we see it going forward. Number one, all of the deceased donor registrants that I just described coming through our National Registry or through iPhone and the iPhone Health app will be offered the opportunity to register as a living donor. Ultimately, they'll first be given the opportunity to enter what I refer to as this living donor pathway, where they can find out information about what do we mean when we're talking about being a living kidney donor. What are some of the risks that may be associated with that? What are things that they need to contemplate? If they are comfortable moving forward, as I will demonstrate, they will ultimately be able to progress towards actually being tested to see if they can be a living donor. Additionally, and this is something that we learned from our consumer research that we did, is that if an individual is responding to a call to action where someone they know or someone they have seen a story about that needs a transplant, we want to allow them to directly enter in the living donor pathway. And then at the end of that living donor pathway transaction, we will also give them the opportunity, if they so choose, to register to be a deceased donor. But we did hear from some of the public that making them register to be a deceased donor first may be a hurdle. This entire project is about removing barriers, not putting up more barriers. So we do have this dual pathway so that we can make sure we are giving the consumers the ability to check out living donation in the manner that makes sense for them. Next slide. So this is an overview. You're going to see walk through it, but in general, the prospect is asked to fill out an initial health questionnaire to help us screen whether or not it looks like it makes sense for them to be a living donor. Eventually, they would go through the process of receiving a test kit. So this is very similar to what you might see with 23andMe or Ancestry.com, where they provide a saliva sample. That sample is then mailed to our third-party lab partner, who is CareDx, for testing at no cost to the potential donor. Then the lab will determine the blood type HLA typing that is uploaded onto a dashboard that is then accessed through a secure database in partnership with UNOS, who is giving us the ability to use UNOS UNET authentication. So we make sure the appropriate people at transplant centers have access to the blood type and HLA and contact information for the potential donor. Transplant centers are then notified that they have a potential donor that they need to check out, and they can contact to enter further testing to see if this person does eventually go on to being a living donor. Next slide. So these are some of the facts and risks that are going to be shared with the person when they're thinking about entering this pathway. Time to recover, insurance and expected costs, the short-term and long-term health risks that may be associated with this, and then links to more detailed information. They can dig as deep as they want to. This is just the initial information that we'll be providing on the screen. Next slide. So these are the health screening questions I referred to. A lot of debate back and forth with our small group and our panel that I showed you earlier that are helping influence and inform us as we move forward. So we wanted to keep this pretty short, particularly for our consumers online. Height and weight so that we can calculate BMI, and that has been set pretty high. We don't want to screen out too many people, whether or not you've been diagnosed with diabetes, are you currently being treated for heart disease, and importantly, the ability to miss 2 to 4 weeks for work. And this is a question we're gonna monitor. We know this is a hot topic in the community. We don't want people saying they can't be a donor because they can't miss work when they have opportunities to go to an organization like NLDAC to see if we can assuage that barrier. So we don't want people, too many people saying they can't miss 2 to 4 weeks for work when we have the ability to hopefully help change that situation for them. Next slide. So this is ultimately what the kit hopefully will look like, something very similar to this. Currently, we're in pilot testing mode, so it's pretty bland, but you can see here the opportunity for branding for what the kit may ultimately end up looking like. Next slide. I referenced earlier, we've done a tremendous amount of community research, public feedback. We've been presenting to key stakeholders at annual meetings like the American Society for Transplant Surgeons, the American Transplant Congress, and other organizations and partners as we've been doing this, showing them the key simulations to make sure that we are getting as many questions as we can up front, but to also let them know what we're thinking and that they will be seeing this coming soon. Next slide. So the proof of concept is something else that we were wanted to make sure that getting a sample from saliva, making sure that when we tested ABO and HLA, from the saliva sample, that it was 100% accurate to what a serum or blood sample would be. So we were able to work with the University of North Carolina to do this testing, and excited to say that 100% of the comparisons came back as exact matches. So we were confident that the samples we were getting from saliva would be as accurate as a serum sample. Next slide. I talked about the consumer feedback. Testing to make sure that they understood the questions we were asking, that the registry flow made sense to the consumer. And that is where we learned, for example, that consumers were interested in being able to enter the living donor pathway directly without having to first register as a donor. The feedback has been very positive. Next slide. So we're currently in our pilot study phase. The purpose of the pilot is to make sure the user experience from the potential living donor side is easy. We also wanted to test the back end to make sure that our transplant centers were able to access and had the information that they needed to move forward with a potential living donor. Next slide. So currently our goal is to have 200 prior living donors. We're using prior living donors. I'll save you the really long story. This was to get around internal review board with our transplant centers, not in a sneaky way, but in an effective way so we can move forward with this project. So we reached out to prior living donors. Our goal is to hopefully end up with 150 samples that are going through the system. Importantly, is getting their feedback on was the process easy for them. Also, so that we could check the system in place with our third-party lab that is helping us with the HLA and blood typing to make sure that that is being uploaded, and then making sure that our transplanted partners on the back end are able to access the information and that it's running smoothly. It is in process. We are getting tremendously positive feedback from our living donors that are going through this process for us. It's also very helpful that these are prior living donors, and that they are knowledgeable consumers, if you will. So they're giving us some really great feedback. I can't remember what the next slide is, so I'm gonna go ahead and say it now. Part of the feedback we were asking is, if this has been an option for you as a prior living donor, is this something you would have been interested in? 65% of the people have said yes. 60% of the people said yes, they would have preferred this. It was easier than having to take time off from work, go to a transplant center to give a blood sample. The 40% that said they would not prefer it is because they preferred the personal connection that they had with the person at the transplant center that was walking them through the process. Those were almost exclusively directed donors to someone that they knew. And we, of course, we can never replace that human interaction with technology, but very excited that 60% of the people said they would have preferred this had it been an option for them. Next slide. So I'm going to show you what the registry actually looks like. So this is a slide that someone would see when they're entering the living donor pathway and they're given the option. You can see here some basic information, but the option to enter the pathway to check their eligibility. Next slide. These are the screening questions that I mentioned. If you answer the questions correctly and submit it, go to the next screen, then you see that it does appear that you are eligible to be a living donor based on those initial screening questions. And then the next question is, do you know someone that you would like to direct your donation to? Or are you interested in entering the system as an altruistic or a non-directed donor? Next slide. The next step in the process is to assist them in choosing their transplant center. These are kidneys in a person, not a kidney in a box. So they have a choice as to where they would like to donate that kidney. It is initially, the screen is initially populated with a zip code that they provided for their, where they live. The consumer does have the ability to go in and put in a different zip code, something else we learned from our consumer research. Though I live in Virginia, I may have family and friends that live in Florida, so I may prefer to be a non-directed or an altruistic donor in the state of Florida versus doing it where I live at home. These were our three pilot centers that we're very grateful to: MedStar Georgetown University, University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, and then University Transplant Center in San Antonio. Next slide. So this is where, once they receive their test kit, this is where you enter the 14-digit kit ID that is then associated with your living donor record. Next slide. We also ask for a phone number. Transplant centers want to make sure they have the ability to reach out to these individuals via phone. Next slide. And then once they successfully submitted this, we let them know that they should expect to be contacted by a transplant center within 30 days of mailing their sample. And we're going to be monitoring that response rate with our transplant center partners. Next slide. So one of the questions we get is, what can I say now? This is in its pilot phase. We have great confidence that we will be launching this nationally sometime in the next year. But right now, really, what we're asking people is to sort of get excitement about this, that we'll be launching the National Living Donor Registry in the next, hopefully sooner than later, but certainly in the next year. And currently, as people are looking for calls to action, we're asking people to, of course, encourage people to continue to register, visit Register Me. Excuse me. And then once again, just another thank you to our funding partner, Fresenius Medical Care Foundation, the incredible work of our other partners, LifeLogix, the United Network for Organ Sharing, CareDx is a lab partner, and the National Kidney Foundation, who's really stepping up, helping us. When an individual is going to the pathway, if they would like to speak to a person, we are going to be using the NKF 1-800 number, once again, because they're really great at this. So they're going to be able to provide that resource to individuals who want to talk to a human, as well as helping us promote this going forward once we launch it to the general public. Next slide. I already talked about the timeline. We can skip this one. There we go. If you have any specific questions, you can reach out to Karen Headley, and I know we're going to be around for questions after this presentation, so I look forward to answering any questions you may have. Last thing I will say is that I mentioned campaign pages for our deceased donor registration. We also anticipate being able to provide the same sort of technology. So if you're an individual or you have a family member that needs a transplant, a kidney transplant, we envision in the future being able to create your own campaign page, where you can direct individuals that are interested in directing a donation to you to be able to access the National Living Donor Registry, the National Living Donor Registry, on via your campaign page. So you could see this as a great call to action via social media and other outlets as people begin to try and find that living donor to help save their life. Thank you. So Sydney, I assume we're waiting for your slides.
I think we are.
There we go.
There we go. Excellent. Thank you so much. I first want to say thank you on behalf of the entire NLDAC team for allowing us to join you today. We're very excited to be here. I'm Sydney Brown. I am the Senior Program Coordinator for NLDAC, short for the National Living Donor Assistance Center. Joseph, you can go ahead to the next slide, please. And so our mission here at NLDAC, in short, is to reduce the financial barriers to living organ donation. And David talked a little bit about that in his presentation, and that is our mission and goal. Next slide. NLDAC is really a collaborative effort between several organizations whose logos you see here, including University of Kansas, ASTS, and Arbor Research, as well as our colleagues at Mayo Clinic. So folks from these different organizations come together and help to inform and create NLDAC. Next slide. A little bit of history, I won't go too deeply into it, but NLDAC is funded by a grant from the Health Resources and Services Administration, HRSA for short, which is part of the federal government. We at NLDAC have been reimbursing travel expenses since 2007. Late last year, we were very fortunate enough to receive additional funding to begin reimbursing donors' lost wages, as well as their dependent care expenses. Transplant professionals such as social workers, nurse coordinators, ILDAs, and financial coordinators submit applications to NLDAC on behalf of their living donors, and then approved donors can get help with their travel costs, lost wages, and dependent care. Next slide. A little bit about the legal framework within which we operate. NOTA, or the National Organ Transplant Act of 1984, most importantly, prohibits the buying and selling of organs. You cannot buy an organ, nor can you sell an organ. And also, NOTA allows the reimbursement of travel, lost wages, and dependent care costs, which are incurred by living donors. ODRIA was passed in 2004. This is the Organ Donation and Recovery Improvement Act. This allows the use of federal dollars to reimburse living donors for their travel and subsistence expenses and other non-medical expenses, as long as they cannot be reimbursed by an insurance company, a state compensation program, or the recipient of the organ themselves. Next slide, please. So eligibility in terms of NLDAC funding, the transplant center's eligibility, they have to be in good standing with OPTN, which is the Organ Procurement and Transplantation Network. Their program and the individual application filer themselves must be registered to file applications with NLDAC. In terms of the organ donor and the recipient of that organ, those folks must be U.S. citizens or lawfully present residents within the United States. They must have their primary residence within the U.S. or its territories. They will provide a verification of their household income, and the recipient's household income must fall within the NLDAC income guidelines. If it does not, then we will ask the recipient to prove financial hardship. To be eligible for our funding through NLDAC, as I said, the organ recipient's income must be within a certain income guideline threshold. These eligibility guidelines were increased last year from 300% of the federal poverty guideline to 350%. Right now, we are able to capture about 70% of U.S. households who will be eligible for NLDAC funding. You'll see in this chart a household of four can make just shy of $93,000 and be able to qualify for assistance through NLDAC. And again, if we have someone who falls in a higher income category, we do have a pathway for folks to demonstrate financial hardship through a financial hardship waiver. Next slide. And so when we talk about NLDAC, how we can help folks, again, we can help with their travel expenses, the reimbursement of lost wages, as well as dependent care. The dependent care can be dependent care for a child, an adult, or an older disabled adult as well. Next slide. And when we're talking about our travel reimbursements, these funds can be used by the donor themselves or their accompanying person. The payment method, we use what's referred to as a controlled value card. This works just like a credit card. And this funding covers expenses such as the donor's transportation, their plane tickets, their Uber, their Lyft to and from the airport, their lodging. We do allow folks to have expenses that would be reimbursed for hotels or Airbnb or VRBO, their meals while they're away from home, and any incidentals. It is important to note that the travel can only be within the U.S., so we cannot reimburse travel internationally. We cover travel from the donor's home address to the transplant center. Next slide. And when we talk about lost wage reimbursement, again, we use a controlled value card. We are moving towards a model that will allow us to use direct deposit, so we're very excited about that. We're getting a lot of feedback from transplant centers that they are also excited about that. So very much looking forward to being able to move to direct deposit. At this time, again, we're using a controlled value card. And when we're reimbursing our donors for their lost wages, they must be working at the time of their donation surgery in order to receive this reimbursement. Again, donors initially receive lost wages on a CVC or controlled value card. Donors would swipe this card just like they would a credit card to make purchases, or they also have the option to withdraw cash from this card at an ATM. Our donors must withdraw their wage reimbursement within a week of their evaluation or their follow-up trips and within 6 weeks of their donation surgery. We reimburse gross income. It is the donor's responsibility to pay any taxes that are due on the money that they receive. We do issue 1099s in January so that donors can work with their tax experts to report this income. The time covered by this reimbursement, we allow 3 days for evaluation, 4 weeks for the donor's surgery and recovery period, and 2 weeks for complications requiring hospitalization or a follow-up trip situation. Next slide. And dependent care reimbursements, again, we are using CVC cards or controlled value cards that operate as a credit card at this time. We are moving to ACH or direct deposit. These cards, the dependent care is issued on the same card as the lost wages, so it works the exact same. They can swipe those cards as payment at a store, or they can go to an ATM and withdraw the cash to reimburse themselves for their expenses. These funds are only to be used for care expenses that are incurred due to their donation. And these funds can be used for babysitters, maybe someone needed a home health aide to come in, extra hours to take care of the little ones at daycare, travel for a family member, maybe mom needs to fly in to take care of the kiddos. We allow $420 per week as reimbursement for childcare and $504 per week for adults. Next slide. And just a little bit related to the overall impact of our programming here at NLDAC. As of earlier this month, we had reimbursed folks just shy of $21 million. We are just under 6,000 surgeries that have been completed. Our applications received are just over 11,000. And we do get our results with regards to our surveys that tell us continuously that at least 75% of our donors that we assist report back to us that we help them significantly with regard to their ability to donate. So in other words, they may have not been able to donate without the assistance from NLDAC. Next slide. This is a chart showing you the percentage of US living donors who have gotten NLDAC support. You'll notice in 2020, we did see a little bit of a dip, but of course, we all know that we are experiencing a pandemic. So we're watching the numbers closely, of course, and we're very happy to say that since our expanded program launched at the end of November last year, our application numbers are rebounding as more transplant centers across the country are able to resume living donor transplants. So we are very hopeful that our graph for next year, and our numbers for 2021 will look even better. Next slide. This table is representative of numbers, donor travel, and the annual expenses and the overall program spending per year. Again, you'll notice a decline in donor spending in 2020 due to COVID-19. Those numbers are rebounding very rapidly as well. And looking forward to seeing what those numbers end up being by the end of this year. Next slide. This is a graph showing you the applications that we received by fiscal year. Again, seeing a dip in 2020. However, just before the pandemic, we were at our record numbers for folks. So fiscal year 19, we had 1,055 applications received. And again, with the expansion of our program, very much looking forward to these numbers coming and rebounding in the next year. This graph is one that hopefully everyone here will be interested in. This is the application numbers that we receive for pediatric patients, recipients. And you will notice, unfortunately, we do not have as many applications for our peds recipients as we would like. So hoping that as we get the word out about NLDAC, that we'll have folks who are filing applications more often for our peds recipients. In 2020, we had a total of 867 applications, and of those, about 58 only were for our peds recipients. So hoping that we are able to, with everyone's help here today, we're able to increase those numbers. Next slide. And folks often ask us when they should apply, and we always tell them to apply as early as possible. Transplant centers can submit their applications to us as soon as the decision is made to bring in a potential living donor. So we always say the sooner the better, go ahead and send us that application. We can help with the evaluation trip, the surgery, and the follow-up trips. We tell people that we cover trips for up to 2 years after donation, and could potentially, if someone has not reached their maximum reimbursement of $6,000 through our program, could potentially help to fund their follow-up for longer, God forbid they had complications. Our applications do need to be approved and funded before the donation surgery takes place. Our review takes about 10 to 15 business days, although we work very hard, our entire staff, to move those applications through more quickly. And how you can apply, you can visit us online for full instructions for application filing and the materials to do so. It is important to note that your NLDAC application must come to us from the transplant center. We do not at this time have a pathway for individuals to apply. So we do encourage you to work with your transplant center. This piece can be a little confusing when we're talking about pediatric patients because, as you all are probably familiar, adults and children may be worked up for transplant and living donation at different centers. So your NLDAC application should be filed by the transplant center who is working most closely with the living donor. So in pediatric cases, this would be the adult patient donor. If there's ever a question that anyone has regarding who should file the NLDAC application on behalf of the family, please just give us a call or shoot us a quick email. No question is a dumb question. Our entire staff is here, and we are very, very happy and excited to help you. So please do not hesitate to reach out to us if you have a question regarding anything, and especially where these applications should be coming to us from. Next slide. So now we get to the really good stuff. This is why we do what we do. This is a photo of Alex Alexander. We call him in the office Alex, and his son Cooper. Alex is Cooper's father. He donated a piece of his liver to Cooper. And I typically don't like to read my slides much, but I will read this aloud. Alex says, as the dad of a sick child, I began to get tunnel vision, pushing other normal concerns aside. For example, finances, career, relationship with friends and family. To have an organization like NLDAC who graciously and caringly helps families through this very difficult time is absolutely irreplaceable. I can't possibly express my gratitude to the NLDAC team. We'll move on to our next slide. This is a photo of Cooper on his first birthday with his family enjoying his giant cupcake. So we were so, so delighted that Cooper and his family were able to provide us these photos and allow them to be shared with you all. And this is where you can find us listed here on this slide. This is a listing of our operations team and how you can get a hold of us by visiting our website, livingdonorassistance.org. You can email us and we encourage emails. Again, no question is a dumb question. Please send us everything you have. Email is NLDAC, N-L-D-A-C at livingdonorassistance.org. We can also be found on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. I'm happy to have questions if you have them.
It looks like we do have a couple questions. I want to say thank you, Sydney and David, for those amazing presentations. I think all of us in the audience are feeling so inspired by the work you're doing. I've got two questions, and then I'd like a couple of other follow-up things. The first one is kind of a comment with a question. And David, this one is maybe one that I would direct to you. One of our attendees says that I had a sister who tested as a match for bone marrow, and she began the work to donate and then was put on pause with no further communication. How does one go about determining if this will still happen or not?
Sure. So that situation with the bone marrow possible transplant is part of the situations that we're trying to eliminate with our National Donate Life Living in a Registry. Because we want to make sure when people present themselves in this act of generosity that they have follow through. I'm getting a little feedback. I don't know if that's me or not. So that's why we're going to be monitoring the response rate from our transplant centers to make sure they are contacting the individuals. One of the things that we have built into the system is there is a disposition code. So the only way a transplant center can take someone off of their active dashboard, someone that said they want to be a donor, is if they put in a disposition code that says, you know, they were lost to follow up, or they had some pre-existing condition that prevented them from being a donor, or something similar. So we're not losing this gift that someone wants to give. And we want to make sure that that loop is being closed and that the potential living donor is completely knowledgeable about what's going on in the process. Because we do know and we hear stories of people contacting transplant centers that say they would like to be a living donor and they don't get a follow-up phone call, they don't get an email back. And that's, you know, we can't waste these acts of generosity. I will say we've started some conversations with the National Marrow Donor Program at Be The Match. We think they are going to be a fantastic partner in this going forward. Our hope is that when someone registers to be a marrow donor, that we can offer them the opportunity to also be tested to be a living kidney donor and vice versa. When someone says, I'm willing to donate a kidney, hopefully you're willing to donate marrow. So we've started some initial conversations with them. So number one, sorry that happened, but that's one of the things we want to make sure is learning from situations like that so that we're closing the loop and not leaving people out there hanging.
Yeah, I love that partnership. You know, we're all stronger when we're working together.
Yeah.
Thank you. I do have another question, David. I think this one would be good for you to address. And the participant said, I've seen many people advertising for organ donation, such as on t-shirts or on billboards, saying my son needs a liver and a kidney, and there's a phone number to call to register to be a living donor on the billboard. I'm wondering how effective is this, and how many living donors register as results of these kinds of advertising and searches like that?
Yeah, so once again, one of the things we're trying to accomplish with this is there's currently not really a way to register as a living donor, certainly not at the national level, no national call to action. So it would be to provide people that are interested in doing this very thing to put some structure around it. We often hear that there is not, there's never been a living donor registry. And I always say, well, actually there is, and it's called Facebook, because that's where people go to try and find a potential living donor. So part of our goal is to put some not restrictive, but guidance circles around people's intent. Number one, to make sure that, you know, people's interest is going to be followed up. I'm assuming, you know, most of those phone numbers are probably the phone number of a transplant center where the patient is waiting. I will say we hear a tremendous amount of success with those kinds of, there was a, I say famous in quotes, case where there was a gentleman that walked around Disney World all day wearing a t-shirt that said he needed a kidney. And he ended up getting a living donor out of that. So, you know, our community oftentimes sort of poo-poos people advertising for transplants. I always say that until you've had a loved one or someone that needed a transplant, you'll do anything you can. So I sort of applaud people's creativity. And a lot of what we're doing is stealing their good ideas and trying to make it a little more, put some structure around what people are already doing out there on their own.
And I think you're addressing it also through those pages, right?
The campaign pages.
Yeah, the campaign pages.
Yeah, that's going to be a great way for people to offer the opportunity for someone to say, I would like to donate to Elizabeth, who's waiting for a kidney, and to be able to do it in a manner where we know they're going to get feedback. We know they're going to get follow-up from a transplant center. And the answer may be no, but at least we're getting to that answer. They're not sort of hanging out there wondering what's going to happen.
Well, I know we experienced when our son went on the list, I was at work and I had probably 15 or 20 people come up to me at work and they offered, they said, how can I get tested? How can I be a part of helping your son? So that altruism is out there.
Yeah. And one of the hopeful side benefits of this is, so for your example, someone could have gone through a campaign page. They would say, I would like to donate to Elizabeth's son. One of the questions we ask is, if you are not ultimately a match for Elizabeth's son, are you willing to donate to someone else? Mm-hmm. So that's taking advantage. I mentioned before, for every 35 clear donors that actually become donors, there may be another 26 that are willing to donate and are healthy enough to. So we can then capture that generosity of those 26, don't lose them to the system because they weren't a match for Elizabeth's son, and let's use them, and particularly let's use them, get them involved in KPD chains. You know, we could see many, many more transplants using some of these non-directed altruistic donors to kick off kidney pair donation chains.
Absolutely. Reagan put in the comments that she, first of all, wants to thank you both for your presentations. And she's mentioned that they run a nonprofit in Pittsburgh and they have families who serve who are doing these kinds of things, like doing the advertising to get their message out there. And if you think about the impact of getting a transplant, you know, particularly for our pediatric patients, you know, the quality of life after, when they are not on dialysis, you know, you can't even quantify how different life is on dialysis and post-transplant. And so thank you both for that. Cindy, when we're looking at the three things that parents or that donors are, that they list are the biggest barriers, being travel and lost wages and the need for care for family members. Do you have any advice for people who maybe don't fit into that dollar range if they're exceeding? Could you address that?
Sure, absolutely. Yes, thank you. I would say first and foremost, whatever transplant center you are working with, your transplant social worker is going to be one of your go-to people because they're going to have the resources, not only NLDAC resources, but other programs that are going to be helpful. CODA is a national organization that is very, very engaged and involved in helping folks. Help Hope Live is another organization I know that we worked with a lot when I was a transplant social worker in Indiana for a number of years. So but again, there are probably, since I left that role, there may be even more resources out there. And I would say your best point of contact is either going to be your social worker on the transplant team and or your financial coordinator.
Okay, thank you for that. I was really kind of surprised about the small number of pediatric donations that are going through your office. What do you think is causing that? I mean, such a dramatic difference.
Sure. You know, I don't know this to be 100% true, but I think that we just all need to work together to get the word out about these different organizations such as NLDAC who are out here. You know, we had a session with someone recently and they referred to us as a hidden gem. And that kind of tugged at my heart a little bit because I was thinking, no, we don't want to be a hidden gem. We want to be out there on the forefront so that anybody who may need our funding and our reimbursement can reach out to us and they know that we're here. So for NLDAC specifically, we would just ask of the transplant centers, just make sure that you are educating your staff and that they know that we're here.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. David, I was just looking at some of the numbers put out, and are we still thinking there's about 1,900 or 2,000 children currently on the waiting list?
That sounds about right. I'll be frank enough to say I haven't looked at that in a while, but that sounds about right.
Okay. Yeah, so... So if we're all of us coming to this conference, it's because pediatric transplantation is very near and dear to us. And I think sometimes when we look at numbers like 2,000, we need to remember that it's 2,000 families mm-hmm. that are impacted. And so it might be one organ transplanted, but every other member of the family is impacted. So I think all of your impact numbers we could probably multiply by 30 or 40 when you really think about everyone who's walking that journey with the child and with the family.
Yeah, and that's part of why you talked about that sort of creative umbrella early on about providing hope, healing, and life to as many people as possible as creatively as necessary. Because we recognize it's not just the individual that's waiting. Oftentimes, the most well-adjusted person that's the most comfortable with the situation is the patient that's waiting for the transplant, and the people that are the most sort of anxious about, you talked about Alex, are the most anxious are the family members. So we certainly recognize the impact that this has on the entire family. You're not just saving the life and healing the life of that one person. You're really saving an entire family's sort of lifestyle.
Elizabeth, if I could add to your last comment, I mean, if you think about the way parents are affected by donation, you often have one parent who is caring for the child, whether in the hospital or having to earn a living, and the other one is the living donor potentially. And then there, so you have a lot of impact there within one household, a lot more than just if it was a donor outside the household who was donating.
Absolutely. Thank you. Yeah, that's a great point. When it's a family member, you're sending two of your family into surgery, not just one. I'm going to just check real quickly over on the chat to see if we've got any other questions, and then I'll give you guys a minute or two to close. And I want to make sure I invite everyone to the closing session. I just feel so enriched by all of the presentations today, and I feel inspired and so thankful to be here. So, David, any closing remarks?
Just thank you for the opportunity. We appreciate everything you're doing. We certainly appreciate the inspiration for National Pediatric Transplant Week. Like I said, it's one of our most popular weeks, but so excited to be able to celebrate the success stories, and I hope that we have more success stories in the future as a result of the work that we're doing. And then I just want to shout out to Sydney and Kim Gifford. Hillary and I, one of our staff members, were texting back and forth. We need to set up a conference call with you guys to brainstorm a little bit about how we can make sure that we're shining the light on what NLDAC is doing and figure out a way if we can work it into the flow of the system. So if people get hung up on that ability to miss work question, we want to have a great place for them to go to have that conversation, because we don't want, you know, to accidentally rule out a third of the people when there's resources available that can help eliminate that hurdle. So we'll be reaching out to you guys.
Thank you, everybody, to Elizabeth for moderating, for Sydney and David for giving their time. And again, as Liz mentioned, I would encourage everybody to go to the final session, which is all COVID. And so I expect there will be a lot of questions there. So see you there, and thank you to everybody else.
Thanks, Joseph. Yes.
Absolutely. Thanks, everyone.